so you have as much or more interest in this as I do. And it's something that gives us insight into our origins as a species, as a reference, we're going to refer to the southern far to the north, flowing out into the South Mediterranean. So, therefore, the downstream area of the Nile flow is going to be called Lower Egypt. Upper Egypt. Lower Egypt. So let's begin with this beautiful satellite view of, in fact, I'd imagine it's from the International Space Station, which is perhaps a very fitting way to open this book, because it's a testament to our current level of technology. Just Mr. civilization lasting for 3,000 years. Ancient Rome only lasted maybe 1,000 at most, if you really, really stretch it out. And these people lasted for 3,000 years, roughly intact, the same religion and the same architecture and writings, hieroglyphs. Which is you think of how you can kind of roughly work or melt metals down to, what's the word? You guys are all gonna know the word, but when you have gold mixed in with other metals and you melt it down to extract the gold, you sublimate it, I believe it's called. And I feel like this civilization is the sublimation, which I think is actually a term Nietzsche used a lot. It's like kind of the, we're in some vague prehistoric state, disbanded tribes and warring neighbors in minor nations, and then this man, traditionally unifying the northern and southern areas of the Nile, creating one vast empire along this magnificently historically important river. And I'm rambling on way too much and not showing you enough pictures, but I'm just so jazzed about this book. Yes, I just said jazzed. I'm a fusion of many things, and a nerd is certainly one of those. I feel like Joe Para right now, the way I'm talking, and I love it. The reality was rather more complex. Archaeological finds testify to the existence of a nameless king, known as the Scorpion King, after the figure appearing on a ceremonial mace, who reigned at the end of the pre-dynastic period between 3150 and 3050 BC, before Christ. Many Egyptologists placed the Scorpion King in the so-called Dynasty Zero, making it the original dynasty, really, along with Narmer, perhaps the father of Menes. And the Museum of Cairo contains the photo of Narmer palette. Okay, so let's designed and built by the is your emotip. Something of the Leonardo da Vinci of his era, and elevated to almost a defined status by subsequent generations. We have far more information about the Fourth Dynasty, thanks to archaeological finds. Period saw reigns of pyramid building pharaohs Snefru, Khufu, Khafre, and Menkaure, and was one of the most remarkable epochs in history, with Egypt distinguished by an elevated level of social, cultural, and artistic organization, which really is phenomenal when you think about it. The pharaoh was at the top of the hierarchical pyramid, with the sacerdotal class-wielding great political power a step lower. Sophistication of the incorporation of this bird behind the brain of this pharaoh. His brain was, I guess it doesn't say who it is, but if anybody is interested in the more spiritual explorations and really kind of all the fringe yet very reputable research done into the spiritual, the very extremely sophisticated spiritual elements of these pyramids, pyramid-oriented pharaohs. I would highly recommend checking out John Anthony West, the recently deceased, just a month or two ago, actually. Sadly enough, John Anthony West and Robert Shock's awesome little series called Magical Egypt. It used to be on YouTube. They might still have the first episode up, but it's just a very compelling look at what exactly might have been the motive for all of the grandiose architecture. I think the importance of this bird. intentions true and honest. And I think I love little tidbits like that, that this exact figure is talked about for 5 or 10 minutes by John Anthony West in one of his episodes. So, continue on with the beginning of the... Okay, here we go. Let's briefly say... So... It wasn't until the 12th dynasty that the reign of the pharaoh Amenemhat from 1994 to 1964 BC that central power was reinforced at the expense of the sacerdotal class. The capital was moved and what began? I really wanted to touch upon the African origins, the African suppressing them. That would have been, well, that would have looked really bad, wouldn't it have? So, I think there was active political and existential reasons for them to suppress and whitewash, as you will. So I think it's very cool to think that, you know, Egypt, which we all revere and are so in awe of, fact was, it's very much an African, first and foremost, civilization. So dynasty conquered Nubia with its rich deposits of gold in the Middle Kingdom was a particularly fertile period for sculpture, the working of gold, civil and military architecture, and in fact, literature above all. Sinai desert. specifically anti-Jewish or anti-Semitic, perhaps even anti-Hyksos. So, I hope you guys recognize that I am purely, very much enthused by learning about history, and I simply want to know the truth that the facts point to. So, that was all to say that I was never told about the prelude to the Jews being enslaved by the Egyptians. It's always very black and white, and the Jews are the good guys and the Egyptians were the bad guys, but I think rarely in history is that ever so easily the case, except in high school textbooks where they purposely write them that way so it's easy to digest, and the less critical thinkers of those readers of those books become patriots. But that's, again, just to say I'm out for truth and to squash any prepossessions of mine that go against facts. So, there was a period of transition called the Second Intermediate Period that perhaps as a result of the weakness of the pharaohs of the 13th and 14th dynasties saw the gradual infiltration of the Nile Delta by nomads. Semitic or Jewish origin, perhaps arriving from the Asiatic steppes. Now these people were called the Hyksos, name deriving from the Greek form of heka, kasut, or heads of foreign countries, the capital of Egypt. This is fascinating that the Hyksos actually dominated Egypt for 250 years and spanned the 15th, 16th, and 17th dynasties, which saw numerous successive pharaohs, of whom only a few names and rare works are known. So interesting, you know, like, I just wish, I feel like I'm never being told the whole story, so I get so jazzed when I, when I learn this history. It's so cool. So, the Second Intermediate Period concluded around 1550 BC. Accession of Amos the First, the progenitor of the 18th dynasty, during which Egypt was finally freed from foreign domination. In this period now, the so-called New Kingdom saw great monarchs. These are, of course, the famous ones we always hear about, or at least I do. History Channel shows that I stopped watching a long time ago. Queen Hatshepsut, Thutmose III, and one of the greatest sovereigns and warriors of Thutmose was, I guess, and Amenhotep IV, better known as Akhenaten, or the creator of the Armana heresy, who introduced the gold solar disk. to unify them under a more potent form of religion. That is, if the previous type of religion, it of course was already a couple thousand years old at this point, was waning and slowly disintegrating and losing its potency. As Christianity very much so is today. And so, interestingly enough, that does coincide with a period of rebirth and prosperity which continued into the 19th dynasty, all the way to 1185 BC. Which is just around the great collapse of civilization. There's an awesome lecture on YouTube called that, if you are interested. And there was apparently a big dark age around 1000 BC from 900, or obviously the other way around, from like 1200 to 900 BC. There was a dark age. All of the Mediterranean basin, essentially. And it was about the sea peoples, I think, they attributed to, but nobody knows precisely who the sea peoples actually are or where they come from. Another fascinating mystery, but so we have. So much effort, and I have very little time, but I be able to connect and share my fascination and love of history and science and past and future speculation with the Kardashev scale and the Fermi paradox that you guys love. And I also love, actually have a couple of things, ideas I'm working on for you guys, which hopefully are a little less rambly and more right to the point. Carl Jung's Aeon, in which he he tries to ground of our consciousness, very much incorporating Egyptian mythology, in a kind of like a wave of a successive series of waves, because they always come in sets, don't they? At least as a surfer, I can attest to that in my little area of experience. But damn, I just love, fascinated. Into you and your life and me, and it's into perspective. So there's a lot out there to learn, guys, and I guess that's all to say that I'm happy you're sticking with me. So I'll leave it there. Just want to say thank you so much to all my Patreon supporters, my PayPal contributors and donators, and Sirius, thank you for your huge $100 donation in my live chat last night. I don't know, you guys are all great, and I can't thank you enough, so I hope you sleep extremely well tonight. I hope you're comfortable. I hope you get a lot of rest. And you go, and you kick tomorrow's ass.